there are some conditions required for a chemical reaction or a chemical change to take place. For example, if we have any two reactants and they have to undergo a chemical reaction, can they just react on their own? Say we keep the two reactants on table, will they react? No, they will not. There are always some conditions required for a chemical reaction to take place. For example, if there are two reactants A and B, in order for them to react, they need some condition. Say, the first condition required is, we need to bring the two reactants in contact with one another. So the first condition that is required for a chemical reaction to take place is the two reactants are made to come in contact with one another. That is, we mix the reactants. This we can see in this experiment. When we drop a piece of sodium in water, we bring them in contact with one another. If we do not drop the sodium piece in water, there is no chemical reaction taking place. But as soon as we drop this piece of sodium in a beaker containing water, as we mix the two, you see a reaction taking place. Sodium piece catches fire. This is an exothermic reaction. So the two reactants, sodium and water, when they are made to react, that is, we mix them, we bring them in close contact, only then the chemical reaction takes place. Similarly, some reactions take place only in the liquid form, that is, only in the solution form. So we take silver nitrate in the liquid state, we add sodium chloride again in the liquid state, so it forms a white precipitate. The reaction takes place only when the two reactants are in the solution state, that is in the liquid state. Had we taken solid sodium chloride, no reaction would have taken place. But in this case, we take the two reactants in the solution state, only then the chemical reaction takes place. Some other reactions, they require heat. For example, copper carbonate. This solid is a stable solid. So if we keep it on a table, we keep it anywhere, no reaction will take place. It is a very stable compound. But when we heat this copper carbonate, observe what happens. So now, as we heat this copper carbonate, which is in the solid form, on heating, it changes into a black compound, that is copper oxide, and a gas is released, which can be seen through the bubbles rising. This contains lime water. The gas turns lime water milky. That means the gas evolved is carbon dioxide. So in this case, if we just keep copper carbonate without heating it, it is a very stable compound. No chemical reaction will take place. But when we heat this copper carbonate, it forms a black residue, that is copper oxide, and the gas is released, which turns lime water milky. The gas released is carbon dioxide. So this reaction involves the presence of heat. Some reactions require the presence of light. For example, photosynthesis reaction. It takes sunlight, carbon dioxide, and water. It forms oxygen and food for itself. So this photosynthesis reaction requires the presence of light. The reactions which take place only in the presence of light are known as photolysis reactions. Photolysis comes from two words, photo and lysis. This photo means light. So the reactions which take place only in the presence of light are known as photolysis reactions. Some reactions take place only when electric current is made to pass through them. For example, water. Water is made from hydrogen and oxygen. Now, when we pass electric current through water, observe what happens. We are carrying out electrolysis of water. How this reaction takes place, you'll study later. But when we pass electric current through water, two gases are released. So you see the bubbles being formed at the two ends. Two gases are released. Both the gases are collected in different test tubes. Now we'll test the two gases being released. So the first gas, it burns with a pop sound. This is a test for hydrogen. And the other gas, it rekindles a glowing splint. So this gas is oxygen. So when we pass electric current through water, it forms hydrogen and oxygen. Some reactions take place only when we apply some pressure. For example, the formation of ammonia. Ammonia is formed from nitrogen and hydrogen. But if this reaction, if we do not apply this high pressure of 200 atmosphere, the reaction will not take place. Let's see how this reaction, that is the formation of ammonia, takes place in the ammonia plants. So at the industrial level, ammonia is prepared from nitrogen and hydrogen. Now in this, the first chamber is the compression pump. In this we have nitrogen and hydrogen molecules. We apply a high pressure of 200 atmosphere. So when it is compressed to a very high pressure, then the atoms separate out. The hydrogen and nitrogen atoms, they separate out. They are passed to another chamber, and this is how they lead to the formation of ammonia. So during the formation of ammonia, we need a very high pressure of 200 atmosphere. Only then the reaction takes place. In this setup, we take hydrogen peroxide and there is manganese dioxide powder in this flask. Now, we'll add some hydrogen peroxide to this manganese dioxide. Observe what happens. So as this hydrogen peroxide is added to manganese dioxide, the hydrogen peroxide molecules, they decompose. They form oxygen and water. But you see that manganese dioxide is not taking part in the reaction. So oxygen, the gas being formed, is released. This gas can be collected. You see the bubbles being formed. These bubbles are of oxygen gas and the gas can be collected. So in this case, manganese dioxide was used so that hydrogen peroxide undergoes the decomposition reaction, but manganese dioxide does not take part in the reaction. So in this case, you observed that manganese dioxide was not taking part in the reaction. It only helped in the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen. This hydrogen peroxide decomposes to form water and oxygen. Manganese dioxide, that is MnO2, it only facilitates the reaction. It increases the rate of the reaction. This is not involved in the reaction. So this manganese dioxide we call a catalyst. A catalyst is a substance which only changes the rate of the reaction. In this case, we observed that manganese dioxide helps in increasing the rate of the reaction. It does not take part in the reaction. So catalysts, they do not take part in the reaction. They only help in changing the rate of the reaction. For example, in this case, KClO3, it decomposes to form potassium chloride. and oxygen at a very high temperature of 700 degrees Celsius. Now this is a very high temperature. In case we use a substance that is MnO2, again manganese dioxide, the decomposition of potassium chlorate takes place at a much lower temperature, that is 300 degrees Celsius. So this is where we use catalysts. So we use catalysts for two purposes. Number one, in some cases, catalysts help in the reaction to take place. And number two, when the temperature at which a certain reaction takes place is very high, the catalysts, they help in increasing the rate of the reaction, so it takes place at a much lower temperature. So in this case, manganese dioxide, it acts as a catalyst. It does not take part in the reaction. It only helps in increasing the rate of the reaction. So there are two types of catalysts. We said that catalyst is something that changes the rate of reaction. So some catalysts, they are required for accelerating the rate of reaction. So in some cases, when the reaction is taking place at a very slow rate, we use catalysts. For example, we used MnO2 for the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen. So in this case, MnO2 is increasing the rate of the reaction. So MnO2 is a positive catalyst. It helps in accelerating the rate of reaction. But sometimes, if the reaction is very explosive, it's very vigorous in nature, very explosive, we need catalysts to retard or to slow down the rate of reaction. So such catalysts which retard the rate of reaction are known as negative catalysts. For example, the oxidation of chloroform that takes place in the presence of alcohol. This is a very vigorous reaction, so in order to slow it down, we use alcohol. So when a reaction is very explosive or rigorous in nature, we need to retard the rate of reaction. Such catalysts are known as negative catalysts. So positive catalysts, they increase or accelerate the rate of reaction, and negative catalysts, they retard the rate of reaction. But the catalysts, they only change the rate of reaction. They do not take part in the chemical reaction. So we have seen the different conditions that are required for a chemical reaction or a chemical change to take place. Number one, mixing or close contact. That is, at times the reactants, they have to be mixed so that the chemical reaction takes place. Some reactions take place only in the solution form. So the reactants have to be in the liquid state, only then they react. At times, we need heat for the chemical reaction to take place. So some compounds or some reactants, they are very stable. They do not react on their own. Only when we provide some heat, the chemical reaction takes place. Some reactions, like photosynthesis, they take place in the presence of light. Such reactions are known as photolysis reactions. Some reactions take place only when electric current is made to pass through them. For example, the electrolysis of water, that takes place only when we pass electricity or electric current through water. Some reactions, they need a very high pressure. For example, the formation of ammonia, only when we apply a very high pressure of 200 atmosphere, it forms ammonia. And some reactions require the presence of a catalyst. There are two types of catalysts. Positive catalysts, they increase or accelerate the rate of reaction. And negative catalysts, they retard the rate of reaction. But catalysts do not participate in the chemical reaction. They only change the rate of reaction. So these are the different conditions that are required for a chemical change to take place.